It's our pleasure today to introduce the educator that we agreed in the conference room seconds ago has had the biggest impact on our lives and our careers as future educators and as educators in whatever profession that we end up in whatever interim.
And as teachers, we all know that modeling is a huge aspect of teaching. So this presenter has modeled for us what it means to be a true language teacher.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the one and only Rose Potter.
Yay! Thank you.
So I went into the field to completely oblivious to what lesson planning was. I don't remember anyone telling me to do it in a specific way. That was in 1972. And I have taught off and on all those years and all different kinds. I taught pre-K all the way to university students. And what I can tell you for sure is it's different now.
I thought two things. How lucky I was to be a teacher of languages. And not a teacher who had to train kids to take a standardized test. And that way we are very, very, very lucky. And there's another thing, how lucky I was to teach a subject that so few people really understood. So I had more autonomy. I think in really big districts, you may not have that autonomy that I had, but it was really fabulous because my classroom was my little castle, right? And to a certain extent, it always will be if you're a LOAT teacher. Because you're not teaching to a standardized test and you have that opportunity to do communication with your students every day, which builds that relationship with your students. So we as a group are best prepared to take what this gentleman has said and turn it into action. And the reason I am so interested and excited in the 5E's lesson is because the elements of it are something that any teacher can apply to any template you might be using. We're gonna be talking about a little bit later this afternoon, but for right now, taking a look in any handout, the video, for example, everything that you see, this handout, everything is gonna be there for you that you can download. So, moving forward, I have some easy questions for you. Y'all ready for some easy questions? I know if you've ever seen me present, you know I've got these easy questions, but I hate to tell you, they're a little bit different this time. And I know you're gonna do well and you're all gonna know the answer immediately. What is the capital of Pennsylvania? Laura, can you tell me what the capital of Pennsylvania is? You studied it in the fifth grade. You learned all your states and capitals or fourth or something. Well, hold on. No, Laura, I guess you've made that big mistake a lot of people make when they think the biggest city is also the capital. But here is what I always hated when teachers did this. Hated it. Is there anybody here that can help Rosie with this one? No. I hated that. So, right now, I want you to turn to people near you and say, I have no idea, or here's what I think. Hola, hola. Hola, hola. You do have internet access. Hola, hola. 5 seconds. Okay, hola, hola. Who thinks they know the capital? Okay, Tabata, what do you think?
Harrisburg.
Woo! Nothing like that. Did you know that off the top of your head?
Yes.
Oh, how come?
Because I live in Pennsylvania for 2 years.
There you go. And I also know that Vanessa knew it as well.
Same reason.
Okay, so people that lived in Pennsylvania, that was a piece of easy cake, right? But for the rest of us, Laura, how did it make you feel when I called on you? Cold calling. We do it every single day to our students. We make them feel horrible. We call on them and we expect an immediate answer. Let me ask you another quick question. See how you feel about this one. Now this time, what is the capital of Washington? And by the way, turn to your partner, discuss it, and when you're ready, raise your hand and let me know that you know the answer.
That's the best way.
Anybody think they know? Alejandra, do you think you know? Did you talk to Luisa about it?
Yeah.
Luisa, what did I, listen, I heard this correct answer up here. but I'm not going to call on the person I think had the correct answer. I'm going to say, Louisa, what did your partner say?
She said Olympia.
Bingo. Olympia it is. Now, I purposely called on the person I thought was more of a struggler because she had an opportunity to work with somebody that helped her. So now no more cold calling. I really want you to think about the kind of tasks we ask our students to do. For example, they just studied past tense in food. Spanish too, they know their food. They studied past tense just yesterday. So you walk in and you say to them, what did you eat last night for dinner? Tell me what you had. In fact, Vicky, what did you have last night for dinner? Vicky, what did you eat last night for dinner? Come on, Vicky, let's go, fast. Let's get it. What'd you eat? Okay. A native speaker comes up with a good answer in Spanish, but she hesitated. Because, you know, when you ask somebody what they had for dinner, there's a lot of things rolling around in their head, especially in a language class. They go, okay, what did I have for dinner? Number one, the tough question, right? You had to think about it. Question number two. Okay, I had it. I ate. What's the verb to eat? Okay, yeah. Okay, comer, ate. But it's not como because that's present. It's got to go to the past tense. That's comí. Okay, yo comí. What did I eat? Oh, yeah. They have to do all of that in their mind. And you're ready to rock forward, right? So we're going to talk a lot today about avoiding cold calling and instead giving kids an opportunity to practice before performance. Give them a chance to practice. When I was taught to teach by Madeline Hunter, who personally gave me in services, she was the person like me presenting, she said, if you ask a question, give students up to 1 minute to think about it before you expect a response. Well, I got to tell you, she was thinking about me as a kid. She's not thinking about the kids in my classroom today. And I would much rather take that minute and say, talk to your partner, give you some oral practice, and then call on somebody and know I'm going to get a decent answer than to just sit in silence and wait and make the child so embarrassed because they can't come up with that quick answer. So practice before performance is part of that confidence building that's going to help you with that belonging that you're trying to create in your classroom. So your students feel really good about being in that classroom. Give them the opportunity to practice before a performance. And what that means for you is that you then can call on the weak students and they are prepared because the stronger student gave them that support. We're going to talk about that in a little bit as well. And why not let them look up the information? Didn't hurt anybody. Are y'all going to remember the capital of Washington now?
Mm-hmm.
And did I achieve my goal of teaching you the capitals of Washington and what was the other one? Pennsylvania? Okay, now we're going to get up and do an activity because you need to kind of move around. And what I want you to do is I want you to remember a favorite activity or a lesson. I want to know how you learned it and what you did. So you notice you have a handout. You can write on it. I want you to go around and talk to at least 10 different people, preferably people you don't know, and ask them, how do you learn best? Do you learn best by watching a movie, audiovisual? How about role playing? What about watching a person demonstrate the content to you? Or just sitting and listening to a lecture? How about teaching others? Or how about reading alone? So get up, 10 people. You've got 3 minutes. Go. Raise your hand if you got 10 responses. Oh, wow. I'm surprised. You know, I cut it off not because I knew you had 10 responses. In fact, I was eyeballing, and the last person I looked at only had 7. So I didn't know some of you actually got to 10, which is awesome. But you know what? I don't have to wait for everybody to get to 10. If I do that, what's my problem? The ones that have 10 get bored, right? So you can always cut that activity short. 7 was plenty. If I had felt that we needed data, really data, I might have said get 20, and then I'd be happy with 10, right? So when you have students collect data like this, it's extremely valuable to you. You can use this data in all sorts of ways. For example, I could open Excel have these categories in an Excel spreadsheet, and we could just do a tally and create a chart to show where our class stands. But instead, we're going to do show of hands. So how many of you said audiovisual? How many of you said role play? One, two, okay. How many said, this one was about seven. How many said watch a demo? One, two, three, four, five. How many said lecture? One, two. How many said teaching others? Whole bunch. Teachers, of course. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 12. About 13 or 14 of you. How many said reading alone? One, two, three, four, okay. So we're all over the plate, aren't we? Before I can get to the meat and a full day workshop, we got to get certain things done. So we walk into lesson planning with all the right concepts. So one of these concepts is, we're going to have some challenge and fun, right? So shout it out. When is challenge fun?
Right level of difficulty.
Right level of difficulty. What else?
Creative.
When it's creative and spurs you on. Anything else? It's nice with other people when it's game-like. I kind of think it's fun when you're successful, right?
Yeah.
So when is it not fun? When you fail. Failure is never fun. So as we talk about lesson planning today, we're going to keep in mind that we want appropriate challenges because we like challenges, right? But we don't want to assure that failure happens in our classroom by giving them something where the proficiency level is too high, for example, or giving them a test that there's no way they're going to complete it in 10 minutes, for example. Studies have been done, and they show that after 2 weeks, students have different retention rates based on how they learn. Doesn't matter if you like the way you learn or not, but that changes according, the amount you retain changes based on how you learn something. So these are the ways that y'all were talking about that were your favorites. I would like you on your yellow piece of paper to put them in order. Which one at the base of the pyramid represents the most learning that after 2 weeks you take with you? You want to learn the states and capitals? Are you going to do some audiovisual? You're going to do a discussion? Reading alone? What would be the very best thing or the worst? Which would be the absolutely worst way to learn states and capitals? What do you think is like the absolute horrific worst way to learn?
Lecture.
How do we usually learn, especially at the university level?
Lecture.
Okay, 10% retention. Well, actually, less than 10% retention. That's a scary thought, isn't it? Okay, what about the next one? What do you think? Shout it out. I love to do, but I know this is true because I'm in a book club. And I can tell you that if I read the book too soon and we get a book club, I'm like, who are those characters? Did we read the same book? 20% would be?
Audiovisual.
Audiovisual.
Very good.
As much as we think they love movies, they're only retaining 20% of that content. What's the next one? Demonstration. That means watching me. I'm going to make a tortilla de patata. Here's how you do it. Three potatoes, an onion. Okay. You're not doing it. You're watching. 50%. Okay, finally. We're getting to something that's reasonable. 50%. What do you think? Discussion. And now we're jumping up to 75%, and it is. And finally, 90%. Now, when you really look at this, you have to ask yourself, if you're going to go to all the trouble to create an activity for your students, why would you do this when you can do some of this? This is not to say you should never do any of the above. Please don't misinterpret this. But if you're not incorporating some of this into it, kind of like what I'm doing this morning, you're all talking together and stuff. If I don't do this, you're not going to retain what we've talked about today. So you're just talking this out. You're teaching others. You see the responses. This is usually the one that blows people away. We think that's so powerful, right? And in a sense, I showed you audiovisual with that movie at the very beginning of our, as we started today. It was a very emotional thing to watch. And you've got a link to watch it again, because just watching it, you're not going to retain a lot of it. So what we have here is active learning, and what we have there is passive learning. So that's another thought we're going to take with us as we start working on our lesson plans later this afternoon. We want the kids to be active learning, doing a lot especially of teaching others. So some classrooms are unintentionally uninviting. That's a Harry Wong quote. Do y'all agree with that? What might make a classroom uninviting? I think this is a little bit uninviting. What's the problem with this classroom?
We have no interaction with each
other. It's hard, isn't it? Because you're in these great big old long rows. I went to the Izon teaching here on campus, and I watched a professor, and he plays music as well. And the cool thing about his music is he asks his students the first day, we're going to be listening to music. What do you want to hear? And he gets a playlist that they create, which is kind of cool, and you may want to keep that in your mind. Interaction with your students. Mm-hmm. For example, I really wanted to talk to you all before we started. So as we approached time, I went and connected. I wanted to know what everybody had in terms of their lesson plan. So that helped me because I was better prepared for what we're going to talk about today. But it also made you feel like a real person, right? Oh gosh, the presenter came back way in that corner and talked to us. Cool. So your students feel exactly the same way. So I just want to show you, this was the very first classroom I walked into at Westlake High School in Austin in 1982. And it was kind of like this. I had advanced Spanish classes, and they had about 15 kids in the class. And then we had, y'all remember the Robin Hood Act? I came back the next year, and my classroom kind of looked like this. And I realized, yikes, how am I going to say hola to every kid? Because there's just so many of them. And I also realized with that many kids, you run into the same issue with any classroom. And the bigger the classroom is, the students come in and they're like, where the heck am I going to sit? So they're looking around trying to make that decision. And others come in. And of course, all the smart kids sit in the front, right? And then kids start segregating. So maybe you have all the black kids sitting in a corner, all the Hispanic kids, all of the kickers, all of the goths. So your classroom becomes a little segregated environment because your students are just kind of making that happen. Or they're sitting with their best friends, and you know the girls are gossiping away about what happened last weekend, and the guys, well, looking at him, you know exactly where he's going to sit, right? It's a given. He's going to sit, and guess who's going to sit back there with him? His buddy. So it's always going to be a problem. And then, of course, in walks you, the Spanish teacher, who you're trying to grab their attention. Ole, ole, ole. You're going to get started. And we have a little problem back here in the corner, so you've got to go take care of that. So then you have another problem in the middle, so you go take care of that. And then this kid appears having a problem, so you get it. And pretty soon, little by little, your classroom becomes utter chaos. What is really important, again, before we get into lesson planning, is the fact that you are able to create effective partnerships and that you are in charge of seating. If your students are in charge of seating, and I know for some people this is just like, they totally disagree with this, but my feeling is you know what your students need. Students very poorly self-select their seating. And I teach, you can turn back and ask my students, they were in a class of four, and when they walked in the classroom, I had arranged the seating. And I mix it up, because otherwise, guess what? The room is static every day, even with four students. I turn that classroom that you saw earlier, this is exactly the same number of desks. Exactly the same number of desks, it's 30. And this was the environment I taught in for many years, and it's really my preferred. Is it the best? No. What works for you is the best. But that worked for me. And what doesn't work for anybody is traditional rows where you've got kids in the back. Do read any research on it. Kids in the front outperform kids in the back every time, even if you put really good kids in the back. So this gives you more access. You let kids know who their partners are. Everybody's got a core partner. And it's really easy to form groups of four. I want you to notice one thing about my seating chart. Miguel y Marta, Raul y Julia, Ana Jose, Elena David. You will never have perfectly even boy, girl, boy, girl. But if you can possibly set up mixed sex partnerships in groups of four, they're going to be more productive because they're not going to fall into the trap that you, I'm not even going to go there because it's kind of, I suppose, sexist for me to say. But I found it really helpful to blend those personalities. And on the first day of class, every semester, when my students walked into my classroom on day one, they had name tags down and they sat in a certain way and they went, we have a seating chart in here, right? And you know what I said? Yes. Well, you do, because you're going to learn better, faster, and more, and with a seating chart, better, faster, and more. So normally, why do kids dislike a seating chart? Why do they hate seating charts so much? When do teachers use them? It's a punishment tool. I'm going to move you. I'm going to move you, Maria. You're talking too much. And I'm going to sit you over here by Carlos. You stop talking. You know, that's what we end up doing, right? I'm just going to change this whole class. I'm going to punish you with this. No. If you start out on day one and you have a seating chart and you do day one, boy, girl, they don't know each other, you're going to have the easiest day on the planet. And that's what I do. I also give them a little interview that first day. And that interview helps me know where to seat them in the future. Because they have to answer a key question that says, how do you feel about this class? A, B, C, D. And the A kids say, I love it. I'm so excited in Spanish. Yay, yay, yay. B, pretty good. I think I'll do well. C, I'm nervous. D, I don't want to be here. Got to have the credit. And then I go home that night and I make stacks of boys and girls. And I start making partnerships. A, B, C, D boys, A, B, C, D girls. I take an A from the boy, a D from the girl. They're going to start as partners. They may not sit there the whole year, but for that day two. And what it really means is sometimes a problem arises, especially I've done this and talked to GT teachers who say, my kid doesn't want to be a teacher. Well, you're not making them be a teacher, but here's what you do with, you got the kids that are really smart. And they say, oh my gosh, I've got to work with Rose. She's the slowest kid in the class. Put me instead. Please, please, please put me with Kara. She's awesome. She's so smart. Or Laura, she knows the capital of Pennsylvania. Give me Laura. And here's what you say. Have you seen the pyramid of learning? Let me tell you about how you learn the most. And let me tell you how I learned the most. I learned my grammar, and I am a grammar queen, because I had to answer the questions of my students. I did not go into teaching being the grammar queen. That developed over time as I continually had to explain to students what was going on. So just think if I'd given my students that opportunity, those really sharp kids, and I tell them, I know you think Rose is real slow, and she is. And I know that you would do a lot more with Mariah. She's smart as a whip. You guys could cover a lot of material, but I want you to have in-depth knowledge. I want you to deeply understand. Therefore, I'm going to put you with Rose because you're going to have to explain a lot to her. But you're not the teacher. I'm the teacher. And then those kids actually can take some, they actually do take ownership. So ultimately in your classroom, look what you create. It's awesome. From your interview, you have a strong, weak, and a strong. So if this strong is absent, guess what? This one's got strongs on either side of it, right? There's always somebody to help. If this strong is absent, they've got these strong people. There's always somebody to help if you have a mixed group. And I'm not saying you should keep it this way all year, change it as you want, but don't tell them you're going to change it at a specific time. That will drive you crazy. And then change it when you want to change it. And guess what? Sometimes a student will come up and say, please let me keep working with fill in the blank, with Sandra. Sandra's helping me so much. You're not going to separate us, are you? Well, do you think I'd separate them? Of course not. I might go to Sandra and say, Rose wants to keep working with you. How do you feel? And usually Sandra's like, hey, guess what? Rose made her first B in Spanish ever. And they take ownership, and they're proud of that. So now we are going to start talking about lesson planning. No problem? Okay. So do y'all remember Madeline Hunter? How many of you remember Madeline Hunter? She was kind of the first person that came up and said, hey, we should have an organized lesson plan. So only two people raised their hands. Can y'all remember any of the steps, her seven steps of lesson planning? Okay, well, I'll tell you what they are then in that case. First of all, she said have an anticipatory set because that means kids can anticipate what they're going to learn. So set the stage for learning. The second one was tell them the objective because all the research shows that if you tell students what they're going to achieve, they're more apt to actually achieve it. Then she said, now you as a teacher do some input and modeling. What do you want them to learn? You model it for them. Next was guided practice. And guess what that turned out to be in most classrooms? The worksheet. Guided practice. Next was independent practice, which I am not a fan of, and I tell you, do not do this today, because you give them independent practice, and that's when it becomes a cell phone fest, right? It's really hard to just say, now do your homework. No, probably not a good plan. And finally, some kind of closure, lesson plan, what we learned today. Don't forget, they had checks for understanding throughout. So that was the original Madeline Hunter. That's kind of how I learned in the 80s. To design a lesson. And it was fabulous and wonderful, and we owe a lot to Madeline Hunter for coming up with these seven steps. The problem is Madeline Hunter was designing lessons for me or for people that were in school in the 60s and 70s when they were a little bit They weren't so hooked onto TV and quick, fast, everything. So when I started working at UT, my students were working on a lesson plan format that was a sort of a hybrid of the Madeline Hunter plan. And I was looking at their lesson plans, and I just didn't like them. I had a 101 class, which were very beginners. They were designing lessons for elementary school. And then I had a 640 class that was working with high school students. I'm going, these are so insipid. We need something different. So Mary Deal, some of you may know Mary Deal. She had this job before me. Mary had in her files a 5 E's lesson plan, which they were using in Round Rock, I think, at the time. I don't know if they still are doing it. But I was looking, I pulled that lesson plan out. I started looking at it. I was thinking, I'm kind of liking this. So I took that plan and I simplified it for 101s, my babies. And their lesson design was so much better that I took the same lesson plan and I gave it to my 640s. And their lessons were so much better that I became passionate about this plan and especially about one aspect of it. We're going to look at it right now. In a nutshell, the lesson plan is called the 5 E's. And the E's are engage, which is a lot like the anticipatory set, explore, which is like nothing, explain, which you think is maybe input modeling, but it's not, elaborate, which maybe is the practice, evaluate, checks for understanding is part of that, right? And then as I was teaching the 5 E's, I realized I needed one more E. So I've invented an extra E. I call it the plus one. My students would forget to close a lesson. So I made them include an exit strategy. And you'll see it on another slide because the students are going to talk about it. Okay. First of all, engagement. And I'm going to do this. I'm going to teach you this as if it were a 5E mini lesson, right? So engage means you try to get the students to really think about what we're going to be discussing. So since a lesson plan is something you have to create, I want you to think a minute. Have you ever made something from scratch where you had to gather the raw materials and make something from scratch? Anything? A dress? A Lego monster like this? What motivated you to get started? Did you use a pattern or set of instructions? Take a minute and talk to a partner about something you have created from scratch. Go. You made some kind of food from scratch. I'm proud of you. Keep that cooking from scratch. Who had something from scratch other than food? A blanket, a quilt.
A quilt for my grandson, yeah.
Awesome. Anybody else make something from scratch that wasn't? Oh, mittens also. Knit or crochet? Crochet. I could crochet. Knitting was totally beyond me. Anybody else? Yes?
Sewing,
yes. I used to love to sew. Fabric got so expensive. No? Anybody else have something that you created from scratch? Yes? Furniture?
Yeah.
But good. So you know when you created something from scratch, you kind of had to be organized, right? How many of you used a recipe or a pattern? Mostly, right? Even though you might have been creative with it and gone your own direction. You've all talked about different things you've made. So now we're going to explore the concept. That means I want you to think about that whole making process and make some discoveries for yourself. So I want to show you this. See if this has any discoveries about that process of creating. This is a little graphic that shows how a product is made. First of all, we have the customer. And in the first screen is how the customer explained it. The second one is how the project leader understood it. The next one is how the analyst designed it. The next one is how the programmer wrote it. The next one is how the business consultant developed it. The next one is how the project was documented. Next one is what operations installed. The next one is how the customer was billed. The next one, how the project was supported. And finally, what the customer really needed. So this is that thought of the creative process. So in your minds now, you've explored that concept of what it takes to create. And there's some pitfalls, right? You know, I love to cook. And I am a really good cook. I mean, es que no tengo abuela, as my friends say. I don't have a grandmother, so sometimes I have to say nice things about myself. But I've loved cooking as my passion, my hobby. I've done it for many, many, many years. But the other day I was cooking, and you get so self-confident, right? And I was making something, and I left out a major ingredient. I know, I make bread every week. I made bread, I left the salt out. And here I had this bread beautifully risen, and I went, oh my gosh, there's absolutely no salt in there. So of course I had to go through the process. But it's important that you know exactly what your steps are, right? So my students have been engaged thinking about this creation process. They've explored the concept of how challenging creating a product can be. It takes a lot of organization. There are certain steps involved. So then my next E is explain. Now, this is a very important thing about this E. This is not the teacher talking. The teacher is not the explainer. The teacher evokes the explanation from students. So I want to know what I wanted my students to figure out. Let's see if they did, right? So I'm going to call upon a student to explain. So to achieve a goal, what is the most important first step?
She said to know what the goal is going to be.
Define the goal. Okay, good. Eduardo, did you have something?
We say that to know the what is the end product that you need to.
To have a very good idea of what your end product is. So guess what? My students get it. And if you didn't get it, you just got it now. And you didn't get it from me. You got it from students. So explain is that process of getting your students to explore and discover content and be able to tell you instead of you telling. I could sit like in a lecture class and tell you all this stuff. Would it be as much fun? Would it be as interesting? Would you get as much out of it? How many of you have read Understanding by Design, or have you talked about it in your districts? Okay, I'm going to tell you that on your agenda, I was going to go into this in a little more detail, and I looked at it last night and went, this is a whole in-service. I don't think I can do it. But I do want to mention something. These two gentlemen made a huge change in unit planning in the field of education. And if you've never heard of them, at least get online and read a little bit about Understanding by Design. Their idea, their concept is to move covering curriculum. I remember we've got to get to chapter 14 by the end of the semester, right? The move from covering the curriculum to creating curriculum for our students and creating curriculum and understanding as well with technology. Using what we've got out there, now let's create some curriculum. And you're doing it in your districts, aren't you? I think a lot of you are. They're saying, let's stop using the book so much, right? Get out there and see what's real to bring real, authentic resources into the classroom. You can thank these guys for that. And there are three stages of what they describe as backward design. And that is exactly what y'all identified, which is you've got to have a plan and you need to know what the goal is. You have to have a result that you want to see in your classroom. And then you determine evidence to show you, yes, I achieved that goal. What do the students do that show you that you achieved the goal? Just now, my goal was for y'all to think about creation and realize that you needed to have a defined goal. So the fact that I could call on a student, three in this case, and basically you said that to me, means I achieved that. That is acceptable evidence. I can move forward. Am I making sense? If you have a question, raise your hand. Finally, the plan itself. What are you going to do in your lesson plan? What am I going to continue to do to help build that skill set in you? Now, when I looked at those, it reminded me a lot of how at UTeach, we ask our students to create an objective. Because the very first step of their lesson plan for all students at all levels of UTeach is to define their objective. And we ask them to create a three-part objective. And the three-part objective has an action, condition, and criteria. And this is what this means. First of all, what are the students actually doing in class? Are they listening to a video and documenting which words they recognize? Are they, as y'all just did, are they walking around and filling in an Excel encuesta, asking and talking to partners to get responses, collecting data? The next one, condition. How are they doing it? Are they using any technology to do it? Are they using paper and pencil? Have you given them some sort of handout or chart for them to work with? And finally, the criteria is directly related to this, which is how do you document that learning? So in a sense, the three-part objective, identify the desired results. That's part of your criteria. What are they going to actually be able to do with it? Determine acceptable evidence, this. And then what is your plan? What action are the students doing and what is their condition? Today, when my students talk to you about their lessons, they're briefly going to mention their objective, but their focus is on the five E's. But I want you to take note that before they came up with that lesson plan, they had an objective. Here's back to our five E's, plus one. And my goal today, let me look next. My goal today was to really, before I turn it over to my students, get y'all to think about what that engage explore concept is. So I want to show you the difference between an anticipatory set and engagement. Here I have what Madeline Hunter would have loved as an anticipatory set. It is a lunch tray from a cafeteria lunch in France. And the kids walk in and they look up at the overhead and they're like, holy cow, that looks like a cafeteria lunch, but what are those? It's hard to see with these windows down. What are they eating? Can y'all see what this is? It's an artichoke. Can you see what that is? Mussels, moule frites. They're having mussels here, a yogurt, a grapefruit. Now, this isn't like a normal cafeteria lunch in the United States, is it? So the kids come in and they're like, oh, I guess we're going to talk about food today. And maybe we're going to do some cultural comparisons. That's our hope. Here's an engagement. The same exact same picture. But as the students walk in before class starts, they also see this. So they walk in and they see, oh, this is a cafeteria meal. It's there for them. They don't have to figure it out. But over here, turn to your partner. What'd you have for your lunch? Compare your lunch with this one. Were they the same? Were they different? And you're not talking to them yet. They're just walking in. But as soon as class starts, you can say, now, do this. And then they turn together and they do it. But they've already thought about it because it was projected before they entered the room. Now, here's an opportunity I'm going to give you all to do a little bit of exploration. I'm not even going to tell you what this is. But here's what I want you to do. Turn to a partner. This needs to be one partner. I'm not going to tell you what this is. I want you to explore it. But I want to hear you speaking this language. And I will only say this. Nuiz edatandusu. Nuiz edatandusu. Cafea. Laranja zucua. Ur minerala. Ardogori. Nuiz edatandusu. Noise datanduzu Luisa, noise datanduzu cafea. E junero? O saritan? O gushitan? E noises. E junero? Saritan? Gushitan? E noises. Noise datanduzu. How did you do?
Good.
Did you communicate?
Yes.
How many of you figured out ardo gori?
I was the...
Yeah. Were you thinking ardo, burning hot?
Yeah.
So what you're thinking? So that's why I was confusing you with that?
Yeah.
You know, especially poor quality wine, when you drink it, there's a burn, right?
Yeah.
So ardo gori is actually red wine. So pat yourself on the back.
What language is this?
It's Basque. So... how did you figure out what I was asking? How did you know what to say? What does ejunero mean?
Good. You like it a lot.
Every day. There's seven little chicks. Now, it's okay if you messed up. So what is ejunero? Daily. What's saritan? Sometimes. What's this? Rarely. And what's this? Never. Okay. Let's take a look. Now, so if my students were confused about that, I like it a lot or a little, and I want to fix that. Zenbat nahi duzu. Zenbat nahi duzu. Asko.
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 Tishibat.
Tishibat.
Es asko.
Es asko.
Gushitak. Remember this? This is what you've been doing. Isn't it fun? Did you like that? Don't you think your students would like that? Of course they would. We have our evaluate, which I'm not going to spend much time on.
I'd like to know what you think a great exit ticket would be for our departure. What kind of exit ticket could I have given you, since I'm too lazy to make it up myself? Think of an exit ticket for this session. What is something that you could ask people to share that would show you that they kind of got what we're talking about?
I'm just going to explain to you a little bit about what COERLL does and what open educational resources are and sort of how this workshop fits into all of that. So at COERLL, we create open educational resources, as Rose mentioned, and these are free to use, so you can go on our website and use them. We have them for, I think, all the languages represented here. But we also want to give you the tools to create your own resources. So this afternoon, you'll be making lessons with Rose's guidance. And so this part is really important. So we don't just want to be giving you static materials to use. We really hope that you can go back and, as Rose was talking about, keep building on what you're doing and creating new things for your students. To explain, when we talk about open educational resources, what we mean by that is any material for teaching or learning that's free or low cost to access online, and that allows you any or all of five rights. So the right to retain the material. So with a traditional textbook, you have the textbook, but it has a copyright, so you can't do anything else with it. And a lot of times now with online resources, there's like a password you need, or you have to have a subscription to something. But with open educational resources, you can retain it for as long as you want. The second thing is redistribute. So with open educational resources, you can give them to your colleagues to use. You can share them with other people. Remix. So you can combine different resources together to make a new resource. You can reuse them. So you can give them to your students, make copies of them. You can also revise, so you can modify them to fit the particular needs of your students. This is something you can't do with a traditional textbook. You can't go in and change things around if they don't fit the population you're working with. But with open educational resources, you are supposed to change the materials you're using. This is important financially because these resources are free and textbooks are really expensive. But it's also important pedagogically because you can't really completely teach a class just with one textbook or with one material. You're always taking things from different places, combining them together, and so you really need to be able to do what's right for your students and choose the right materials, and this allows you to do that. So the thing that runs all of this is Creative Commons licenses. And we gave you a handout. There's a little graph of all the different types of Creative Commons licenses. So you can recognize a Creative Commons license by 2Cs in the circle, and this is opposed to the 1C in the circle of the copyright. And so these licenses tell users how they're allowed to use the materials, and it says what rights the author retains for themselves. If you see this symbol, the attribution symbol, the circle with a person in it, that means that that material you're using, you have to, if you reuse it or give it to anyone else or make a copy of it, all you have to do is make sure that you attribute it to the person who created it. So just put their name on it. The circle with the little arrow in it is share alike. So that means whenever you use a material and you share it with other people, you have to also put a Creative Commons license on it. The circle with the dollar sign on it means non-commercial, so when you see that, it means that you're not allowed to sell the materials, but you can use them in any other way. And the circle with the equal sign in it means no derivatives, so that means you can't make modifications to the materials, but you can still reuse them and make copies of them. These different symbols are all combined to make different licenses. So you can see on this chart, at one end of the spectrum, there's the copyright, which is the least open. On the other end is public domain. And then next to that is CC BY, which means the only thing you have to do is attribute the work to the person who wrote it. And otherwise, you can do whatever you want with it. So this is just the beginning of being open, of using other people's materials, of sharing. So you guys, I know you're sharing your lessons with us. If you did put Creative Commons licenses on them, then everyone here would know what they could do with the content when they downloaded it. They would know that they would have to attribute the work to you, so you'd get credit for it. So it's just a great way of sort of everyone feeling okay about sharing their work together. And then there's other, so this isn't also just about the resources you're using, but it's also about practices. So just everyone being here today, sharing ideas with each other, that's part of open education as well. You can share your work as well. So you're going to create lesson plans later, and we're hoping that you can take a look at these licenses and think about how you want other people to use your work and put a license on the work and then share it with the other people here. So we encourage you all to really think about sharing what you do here with other people.